Good morning. I'm going to talk to you about the thermal characterization of gypsum composites by using differential scanning calorimetry. I'm working in the same project that the previous speaker, so most of the introduction is the same. I will try to pass fast, but just in case there's someone new or any doubt, I will explain the most important concept. So as Beatriz said, everybody knows the energy demand is constantly increasing, and consequently is increasing as well the air pollution. So this situation is promoting the development of new systems for store energy, and also is promoting the use of renewable energy. The solar energy is a good alternative to fossil fuels, since it's clean and universal, everybody can use it. But the problem is that it is intermittent, so it needs to be stored. Many authors have studied the absorption of this solar energy by using the latent heat of the materials. These materials are what we call phase change materials, or PCMs, because they have high heat of fusion, and then melting and solidifying, they are able to absorb and store or release this big amount of energy. In addition, the last two European directives state that at least the 30% of the energy that is consumed in the European community is due to the building performance. So this energy performance is a key to achieve the European Union climate and energy objectives. This is why we have focused in the development of buildings that can have a better energy performance by adding the PCMs. And this way we will reduce the energy consumption in heaters, air conditioners, we will reduce the CO2 emissions, and we will be able to save money, which is also important. And how do they work? Beatriz has explained that when the temperature outside is higher than the melting point of the PCM, this PCM starts to melt. So all the energy is spent in the phase change, what means that the temperature stays constant at this value, okay? For example, if you choose a PCM of 25 Celsius degrees, during the melting transition, you will have this temperature inside the building, okay? On contrary, when it's cold outside, for example, during the night, the PCM will release this energy, giving you this heat, and again, keeping the temperature constant in the melting point. So besides to have high latent heat of fusion and a good melting temperature to be comfortable inside the building, it's important that they have low cost and good availability, because we are going to need a big amount of these PCMs. Of course, non-toxic and non-corrosive. There are going to be people living inside the building, and we don't want to damage the rest of building materials. We can apply them in wallboards, ceilings, floors, shutter of windows, cooling and heating systems, and many more systems. And regarding the ways of incorporation, you can mix them directly with the rest of building materials, or you can previously macroencapsulate it. You have previously seen the advantages of the microencapsulation. We have chosen this technique, and we have also used polymers as cell, because most of polymers has low cost, they are chemically inert with respect to the rest of building materials, and they present low density. And we have chosen gypsum as a building material for applying the PCMs in the buildings because of its good availability, because it is widely used in buildings, it has low cost, it's a good durability, it's easy to incorporate in it new additives, and it can be applied in situ or as a precast slab. So, the global aim of the project is incorporate the PCMs in the gypsum, obtaining gypsum composites with thermoregulating properties. And we have to check that these composites has present thermal properties improvement, we preserve the mechanical properties, the durability, and that there's no gas emissions. In this presentation, I'm going to focus in checking the thermal properties improvement. And the partial aim of which I'm going to talk in this presentation is to get a fast and an easy way to evaluate these thermal properties. We have proposed to use the modulated DSC, DM-DSC, which is a microscale analysis with a sample size lower than 10 milligrams. And with this technique, we evaluate the apparent heat capacity. This apparent heat capacity can be translated in the test capacity. This is the thermal energy store capacity of the material, considering both the sensible and the latent heat of the materials. Once we have this value, we check or we confirm this value at a macroscale analysis of dimensions about 6 per 10 per 3 centimeters. Okay? And besides, with the apparent heat capacity obtained by MDSC and the data required from the macroscale analysis, we can evaluate the, or predict the behavior of these composite materials containing phase change materials. You can see in the slide the materials or the microencapsulated phase change materials that we have used. We have microcapsules from polyethylene and EVA with a core of a paraffin wax called RT27, which has been obtained by spray drying techniques in our lab facilities. The second one microcapsules are from polyesterine, containing as well RT27 and synthesized as well in our lab, but now by polymerization. Finally, a commercial one from polymethyl methacrylate, PMMA, containing another paraffin wax and obtained as well by spray drying. We have also modified the ones from polyethylene by adding carbon nanofibers in order to evaluate how the thermal conductivity affects the results. You can see that we have covered a wide range of particle size from just 4 micrometers for the ones from polyethylene up to 100 or more than 100 micrometers for those from polyesterine. Most all of them has a melting point close to 28 degrees. And regarding the latent heat of fusion, the best one is the ones from the micronals, then the one from the microcapsules from polyethylene, and then the one from polyesterine. Okay? And regarding the gypsum composite manufacturing, we mix the microcapsules with the gypsum, then we add the water and we stir vigorously about 1 minute. Then we pour the mixture in the mold that is shown in the slide. And part of the excess of mass is grinding, or ground, sorry, to get the powder that is applied in the differential scanning calorimetry equipment. Okay? This equipment is shown in the slide. You can see that we put in a position the sample and in another the inert reference, so an empty pan, and we compare the heat flow between both samples as a function of time and temperature. So in a conventional DSC, we just apply a linear heating rate, while in a modulated DSC, we overlay a sinusoidal heating rate, obtaining a complex heating rate like the one in a solid lane in the slide. Okay? With this kind of experiment, we can obtain more thermal properties directly. So we are able to evaluate the apparent heat capacity by MDSC in a direct way, while if using the conventional DSC or using a macroscale equipment, we have to do multi-step experiments that takes long time, so we are gaining time, okay? And it's easier. We have found that for this kind of materials, the good conditions would be, for example, heating rate of 0.5 Celsius per minute, an amplitude of 0.5 Celsius, a period of 100 seconds, and a temperature change from 10 to 40, because if you remember, our melting point is 28, so it's perfectly in this range of temperatures. And in order to check the feasibility of using the modulated DSC for the test capacity evaluation, and also to obtain experimental data which are required in addition to the apparent heat capacity for the prediction of the thermal behavior of the materials containing PCMs, we have designed and built up the installation of shown in the slide. It basically consists in a hollow metallic box through which is constantly passed a liquid whose temperature is controlled by a thermostatic bath. So this way we can control the temperature applied to the block, to the composite material, and measure their temperature variation. You can see in more details this part of the installation. We have the hollow shell and the composite blocks isolated with an insulating structure. And you see that we apply to it a temperature change from 18 to 40 Celsius degrees, and what we do is measure the temperature in 6 different positions and also the incoming and outgoing heat fluxes. Okay? This is the incoming and these are the outgoing heat fluxes. So once I explain the experimental setups, I'm going to show you the results, starting with the microscale results. You can see that independently on the microcapsules type added to the gypsum, the higher the microcapsule percentage, the higher the test capacity, as it was expected. And besides, we observe that adding carbon nanofibers, we obtain a narrower peak, so they really promote a faster energy absorption due to their high thermal conductivity. If we compare the apparent heat capacity curves of composite materials with the same amount of microcapsules, we observe the following tendency shown in the slide, which agrees with the apparent heat capacity tendency of the polymers, since you can see that the apparent heat capacity of microcapsules from polyethylene has the highest apparent heat capacity, and as well the low density polyethylene presents the highest heat capacity. But you have also to take into account that if you just look at the region of the melting transition, close to the 25 degrees, the heat capacity is higher for the microcapsules containing, for the commercial microcapsules, not the one from polyethylene. So it can be concluded that the apparent heat capacity depends on the cell material and also on the latent heat of fusion of the phase change materials. If you transform this apparent heat capacity in an enthalpy variation or in the energy stored by the material when you subject this material to a variation of temperature, as for example if you subject them to a temperature change from 18 to 36 Celsius degree, you can observe the increase in this energy storing capacity. For example, we are able to store 47% more when adding a 15% of the microcapsules from polyethylene. Okay? We are now to compare these values with the ones obtained with the macroscale equipment. Okay? What we have done is to calculate the accumulated heat when, again, the composite materials are subjected to a temperature change from 18 to 36 degrees, but now with the other installation. Okay? In the figure, I'm showing the accumulated heat in baths. This accumulated heat is obtained subtracting the outgoing heat fluxes to the incoming heat flux. If we integrate these curves and divide it by the mass of the material, we obtain the accumulated heat in joules per kilogram. And comparing both values, the ones obtained by MDSC and the ones obtained at macro scale, the deviations are quite low, most of them lower than 5%. So the methods of MDSC would be quite suitable for this kind of experiments. You can find just a problem with the microcapsule from polyethylene that has a deviation of about 14%, and the problem is the ones obtained by modulated DSC, because if you remember, they were of high particle size, so probably when we are ground the material to get the powder, we are destroying most of the microcapsules. So this technique is suitable for most of the materials, but you have to take into account the particle size of the material. Okay? But the main conclusion is that we could use the MDSC as a method for the heat capacity evaluation of composite materials that contains ECMs. And to see more clear the advantage of using this kind of materials, just imagine that we cover a conventional room, that's this one in we are, with one meter cubic of gypsum boards containing a 15% of the microcapsules from polyethylene, and evaluating the test capacity just due to the microcapsules, this is subtracting the kilowatts per hour obtained just because of the gypsum, we are able to save 4.5 kilowatts per hour each time that they work, what are more or less like the energy spent by 3 light bulbs kept on for a whole day. Besides, we are able to reduce in 1.6 kilograms the CO2 emissions. Okay? And finally, we have applied this apparent heat capacity curves obtained by differential scanning calorimetry in a mathematical body model in order to be able to predict the thermal behavior of this material in a real situation. You know that mathematical models are quite useful in order to avoid expensive or even impossible experiments in lab facilities. But in this case, we have, they have a very complex solution because they present boundary conditions movement with the solid-liquid interface. I mean, the PCM is melting, so the part which is solid and liquid is constantly changing. And we have to take that into account when we model the behavior. And one way to avoid this problem is to use the apparent heat capacity as a temperature function. And from this heat capacity, we evaluate which part is liquid and which part is solid. So if you see, we have obtained a very good agreement between the experimental and the theoretical curves. So we can conclude that these curves of apparent heat capacity temperature are really a powerful tool for the thermal behavior of materials that contain PCMs. Just to sum up, I'm going to remember you the main conclusions. The first one was that the MDSC seems to be suitable for heat capacity evaluation of composite materials with PCMs. And studying that, we observed that the higher the microcapsule content, the higher the test capacity, as well that the addition of carbon nanofibers promote faster energy absorption, so it can be useful for some kind of application which needs faster absorption. The apparent heat capacity depends both on the cell type and also in the latent heat of the PCMs. And what is most important, we are able to save 4.5 kilowatts per hour and reduce the CO2 emissions in 1.6 kilograms. And the second main conclusion was that the MDSC heat capacity temperature curves were useful for prediction of the thermal behavior of composite materials with PCMs. So, thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you for a nice presentation. We have time for questions. Some question. No? I have one, sorry. Because you mentioned that there's an influence of the... Oh, you have to take into account the particle size. The particle size. So, is that something that you can measure at your lab before and after the experiment? I mean,
Yes, you can just broke a piece of the block,
yeah.
And by same, for example, you can observe the particle size of the microcapsules. And the problem is that for the modulated DSC analysis, you have to grid or ground. You have to do a powder, so when you do the powder, sometimes you broke the microcapsules if they are very big. Maybe you can modify the cell with a more less rigid cell, and maybe in this way you can grid without broken the microcapsule. That is important because of that.
And this is something that you measured
yes.
during your experiment?
Yes, after the experiments, you check by SEM if you have broken the microcapsules or not. And when you synthesize the microcapsules, you first, by low angle light scattering, you measure the particle size as well.
And the size of the particles, I don't know if
I can show you.
Because you have worked from 1 micron to 100?
4 micrometer to about 100.
100.
Yes. It was like over here. Yes. You see, it goes from about 400 micrometers up to 116 micrometers. Besides, the polyesterene is more rigid than the polyethylene, and maybe that's also contribute to its rupture. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And also, the last question, sorry. You have the capacity to produce, you mentioned spray drying.
Yes, we have a spray drying, even a large scale, maybe 5 kilograms per hour, which is quite enough. because we are working for a company who's want this kind of materials for building applications, so they need bigger, a big amount.
Larger scale.
Yes,
yeah.
A larger scale.